zero pucks given.
Hello and welcome to Zero Pucks Given, the UK ice hockey podcast. We're in partnership with the Hockey Art Co, hockey clothing for hockey people, worn by the best and hated by the rest. Listeners to Zero Pucks Given get a 10% discount on everything site-wide at hockeyartclothing.co.uk. Just use the code ZP10 upon checkout to get your 10% discount. And we are still sponsored by Manscaped, male grooming products redefining the gentleman. You can get 20% off of all Manscaped products from manscaped.com, as well as free shipping when you use the code ZEROPUCKS20, all caps, all one word, ZEROPUCKS20, and that will get you 20% off everything from the performance package to the lawnmower to the weed whacker to the crop preserver, all the stuff for making your gentleman feel very gentlemanly. So, there'll be a little bit at the end of the podcast, a few more details about all of that if you want to hang on and listen to that. And we are also part of the Sports Social Podcast Network, the biggest sports podcast network in Europe. So absolutely delighted to be a part of that. Well, welcome along. I'm Ben. This is episode 98. We are really, really crunching down to that 100 now. We're going to try and put out an episode on the Saturday as well, which will cover all of the semi-finals from the first day of the playoffs. That probably won't be out till Sunday morning, as it's going to be quite a long day. And then Sunday, when we talk about the final, that will be episode 100. I think it's a cracking way to bring up the 100 is for it to be at the playoff final itself, which is going to be fantastic. I think it just looks like an incredible weekend. That day, Saturday, you know what? It might be a bit stressful. It's going to be a bit of a squeeze getting four games into one day. Obviously, only two dressing rooms at Haringey as well. That's going to make it interesting. But I think it's going to be a really exciting day. I think the players are excited. I think the coaches are excited. And we're going to be double checking that right now, because we are going to catch up with Chelmsford Chieftains head coach, Lewis Clifford. Obviously, I spoke to Lewis at the playoffs at MK last year when it was sort of just announced that he was going to be taking over the helm at Chelmsford. So we'll discuss, obviously, his first year, how he's found it, the roster that he's put together. Cliff has signed on for next year, so we hope that a lot of this roster do as well. I'm sure the cogs are already turning, but Cliff's a good poker player. I'm sure he'll keep it quite close to his chest. But anyway, one for everybody, really. I'm sure the Chieftain fans will enjoy hearing from their coach. This is Lewis Clifford. Zero Pucks Given in partnership with the Hockey Art Co, with Manscaped Male Grooming Products, and on the Sports Social Podcast Network. Absolutely delighted to welcome Chieftains head coach, Lewis Clifford. How are you doing, Cliff?
I'm good, thanks, mate. Yourself?
Doing very well, very well. After a fantastic weekend, very professional performance from your lads. As we spoke sort of off air a little bit earlier, you kind of had to take the best couple of periods from them to come through, but quite professional on the Sunday night.
Yeah, it was tough. I think, obviously Oxford are where they are at the moment in terms of, player personnel and league positioning and stuff like that. They came on Saturday and they did really well. It was, early part of the game. I was a bit frustrated with the way we were playing. I thought we were sort of falling into their hands a little bit in the first period. But once we figured it out and started playing the way we needed to play, there was no turning back really for us on Saturday, and then obviously going into a game on Sunday where you know what the score is already, I'm very much an advocate of like never say never, You still have to go there and do the job and be professional. But going into a game 8 goals ahead, it's quite a unique sort of position to be in. And obviously they started again really quite well. Another really good period from the Stars. So, yeah, I'd say across the weekend, if they could have put together, maybe four or five periods of what they managed to do for two periods, they would have they would have been in a much better place. But yeah, we kind of just took it away from them, really, took away everything that they were trying to do, imposed ourselves on the games, and touch wood, I think we managed to get through pretty much unscathed, and book our place at the Final Four.
Yeah, absolutely. And when we spoke, well, a little under a year ago now at Milton Keynes, when you'd first taken the job, you kind of said then you hadn't seen a lot of the league, so you wasn't entirely sure what to expect from it. Has it been what you expected?
Yes and no. I think the league's good, right? So I wasn't expecting it to not be good. So that's not what I'm trying to say. But the standard of the league's really good. Probably higher than it was, well, no, the last time I was in this league, there, you had all the ex-EPL teams in for a couple of years, so
Yeah.
Bramall Bees, Basingstoke Bison, Peterborough, Swindon, etc. And that was obviously the highest standard this league's ever been. But that was a false position, right? A false standard of hockey that wasn't what this league has been historically. And but no, the standard now certainly far higher than it was, last time I really had any involvement in it, as is, which was quite a long time ago.
And obviously, you would have come in, I suppose, with an idea of what you wanted to do within the first year, but finishing second in the league and getting to a sort of cup semi-final must be pretty close.
Yeah, again, I'm coming into it blind, right? So obviously I know that the teams finished fifth last year, not made it through to the Final Four. I think lost in the cup final, is that
Yeah,
correct?
in the cup final, yeah.
Yeah, and really what I'm trying to do is improve on that, right? But at the same time, I'm kind of coming in and going, well, I want to improve on that. I want to make the team better, but I actually don't really know how we stack in relation to the other teams, because I'm a new person that's just coming in and seeing it all for the first time. So a lot of it was guesswork or educated guesswork, I suppose. Speaking to people that have been in the league recently elsewhere, speaking to people that were in Chelmsford last year, and just sort of trying to put together the best team I thought I could. I know a little bit about Streatham from obviously good friends with Michael Farn that was there previously, and Adam Carr before him. So I know a bit about how they operate. I've seen a few of the playoff finals weekends over the last couple of years at Milton Keynes, and obviously that's always top end of the league that you're seeing there. And I just sort of thought, well, I've got what I've got here. I can bring in some bits, and I just want to make the team as best as I possibly can. And that was basically where I was at. And I don't really know what I expected, mate, to be honest, with regards to league positioning and things like that. I suppose, speaking honestly, I didn't come here to try and finish second or to lose in the cup semi-final. But at the same time, sometimes maybe I'm a bit too hard on myself, and maybe you take the small wins and go, well, we've massively improved, and it's good for the future. I don't know, really.
Yeah, I mean, you said before when we me and yourself and Damon were on BBC Essex a couple of weeks ago talking about the Chieftains, and we sort of said then if you could bottle consistency, you'd be an absolute millionaire, because that
Yeah.
seems to be the tricky thing. Obviously, not having maybe all the same guys available week after week after week, and getting them to training with the late nights and everything. So, and that's been the only real down point this year, isn't it? Is the occasional little, losing at home to Romford, away to Invicta.
Yeah, I think it and that is exactly it, mate. That and that's where we have to learn, and as a group we have to, move forward positively into a new season, is that actually, it's not games against Streatham and Slough that have cost us this year. It's the points we dropped early doors against Invicta away. The home game, that's against Solent, we lost. The away one is what it is. I'm not Lots of people go to Solent and lose. That's one that you can sort of strike off as it's not a bad day. It just happens. The one against Romford, and then and other than that, the ones we've lost are the two against Slough, two against Streatham, So it's those points that we dropped. And I'm not saying we should beat Invicta every time we play. I'm not saying we should beat Solent or Romford every time we play them, but that ultimately is what cost us the difference between first and second in the league. And you know, Streatham are the best team in this league, and they're the best team in this league till they're not the best team in this league anymore, right? So they're the best team again for another year. And the reason they are the best team is not because they're massively better than us when we play against them, because actually results have proved they're not really. But they don't lose those other games very often, that, you know, the ones that we have lost. And that's that is a lesson. And it's a lesson that if you learn it, can be a massive positive moving forward. But if you don't learn your lesson and you just take your kit off, go home and go, oh, well, we lost, then it becomes very hard to ever win a league because, you know, the league table never lies.
No, certainly the best team over 28 games is going to be the one at the top, isn't it? It's, you know, there's no really arguing about that. But the you've already announced that you will be continuing with the Chieftains for next year, which was wonderfully accepted by the fans. Everyone's incredibly happy with what you've done. Obviously, the players that you've brought in. But Jordan on this podcast last week, Jordan Lorday, said that it was actually he came to you. Did you find that a lot when you started at Chelmsford? That you all of a sudden your phone was blowing up.
Yeah, it happens all the time. If you're a coach in this league, like, so don't get me wrong, I've known Jordan for a long time. I coached him, I think, under the Eanes or under 15 Southwest. So, you know, this is a relationship that goes back a long way. But I actually, I think I might have said before on a different podcast, like, the Basingstoke thing was very unfortunate, and it's not something that any of us want to see, right? You know, anyone like myself who's devoted a lot of years and a lot of hours and, you know, a lot of blood, sweat and tears to trying to develop young hockey players, you don't want to see any rink close. You don't want to see any team go pop. You don't want to see any lack of opportunities for anyone. But out of the misfortune of Basingstoke, straight away, Basingstoke had two goalies that I knew very well in Metzi and Lords, obviously. And I just thought straight away, well, I've got to get one of them. it's just so happened. It was almost like very quickly things moving. And almost like, I think you're right, he did contact me first, but it was only a matter of probably hours before I probably would have contacted him. Because, you know, you can't win anything without a good goalie.
Yeah, absolutely. And he sort of said he'd be, obviously, with family and work commitments that may get in the way, that if he does play next year, he will stay at Chelmsford, which again will please the Chelmsford fans. But and I know from your appearances on, he was on 4,000 Count with Nicky and the Boys, who was on BBC Essex recently, you don't really like to pick out individual players because we win as a team, lose as a team. But as far as imports go, I can't believe how quickly Damon Porter has settled into this league and this standard. He's been incredible this year.
Yeah, Damon's been great. I think you know, I've been through this process many times, either as an assistant coach or a head coach, where you do not know what you're getting until you get it. So I was actually speaking to Shannon from Oxford on Saturday there before the game, and you know, you can look at an elite prospects page, you can ask the player to send you a video, you can speak to a former coach, all you want, but actually, you still just never know till you see him on the ice.
No.
And the point of that was that everything pointed for Oxford, for like Hullaby to be a really good player, right? His CV, I'm sure that he had a highlight reel of him getting that unreal shot off and everything. And for one reason or another, it just didn't work for him in this league over here.
Yeah.
But, you know, we got the, you know, touch wood again, we got the flip side of that this year. We got lucky. Damo's been phenomenal for us. You know, for a player in his first season in this country, you know, you have to be adaptable when you come to a league like this, right? You're going into places like Solent and Invicta, where you're probably seeing things that you've probably never seen in an ice rink before in your life if you come from a country where they, you know, take hockey a bit more seriously.
Yeah.
You're dealing with the officiating. You're probably seeing some crazy things going on in locker rooms that you've probably never seen before elsewhere. And if you haven't got the right personality for that, it could probably be a match made in hell rather than a match made in heaven, right? And but no, Damo's been fantastic. And like you said, I don't like singling people out. Generally, if you win a game, it's not just because one player's played well. If you lose a game, it's definitely not because one player has played badly. But no, he's been great, mate. He's been I know you've had him on here before. He's been spot on, easy to deal with. And as far as I'm aware, he's loved it here as well.
Yeah, he was terrific when he came on here. As you say, not only adaptable in hockey terms, but I think he's actually enjoyed living in Essex. He's made friends. He's enjoyed the golf and the social side of it as well, which has
Yeah.
been really good to see. And it's something I think that a lot of the fans have pointed out, that there doesn't seem to be any animosity amongst the team, which last season was quite prevalent. So that's something I
Yeah.
think as a coach that you have a massive hand in.
Yeah, you can't have it, right? If like, don't get me wrong, not everyone on the team's best mates with everyone else. Like you do, and you always will have little groups, like, and I don't wouldn't like to use the word cliques, because I don't think we've got a clique at all in our room. But you have guys that come in a car together. Naturally, they arrive together, they get out of the car together, they go. But then I think we've got a team that disappears as soon as they get in the locker room. Often with teams like the one I've built, you could have like existing Chelmsford versus everybody else. Like or whatever, but there's lots of ways divisions can be drawn in a group. But it's important to me. It's always going to be, as long as I've been a coach, as long as I will be a coach, is actually the team comes first, right? And you could be the best player on the team. If you're upsetting people, you're probably going to have to go, because the damage you can do to everybody else, or to the cohesion within that group, is probably going to be such that it offsets how good you are on the ice, because no one's that good, right?
No.
But no, I think we've got an unbelievable group, mate. Like, that room is loud, right? I sit outside in the corridor, like, before practices, and put my skates on, and after, and in between period breaks and stuff, and it's loud, and I can't really hear what's being said, but you trust me, it's not loud because they're arguing because they hate each other. It's just a loud, vibrant place to be, and that's a good sign for me. When it starts being quiet and you could hear a pin drop, we'd probably have an issue, but that's certainly not been the case in that changing room.
No. And pre-game, I mean, whether it's always been a habit of yours as a coach, you've kind of lucked out with the way the Chelmsford rink is planned, because pre-game, you're normally in the balcony for warm-ups, which is directly over the opposing teams. Does that work out quite handy?
Yeah, I've always liked to watch warm-ups. As long as I've been a coach, I always get in up. I'm too early. Do you know what I mean? I actually need to be up there for about a minute and a half of the warm-up to see what their lines they're going with and whatever. When they do their 3-on-2 breakout drills and whatever. But I'll sit there and I'm like, oh, they're just skating around shooting pucks. Oh, they're passing pucks around the circle, right? I actually don't need to see any of that. But at the same time, I don't have anything else to do at that point in time. So,
You've normally got a few suspended players up there to chat with as well.
probably more than I would have liked this year.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I do. I've always watched warm up. I always like to know what the other team's got, what they're sort of looking like. Some teams think they're being clever because they do something in the warm up, and then it's different as soon as the game starts. So I'm not sure what, if that's some sort of like genius thing I think they're coming out with. But no, yeah, I couldn't actually honestly ever tell you what's gone on in our warm up. But I could never tell you, oh, so and so keeps missing the net, or Lorde and Dom look like they haven't stopped the puck the whole warm up. Like I never looked down that end of the ice. I'm
No.
not interested. I see that enough,
Yeah, your work is done on the Tuesday and Thursday, I suppose.
Yeah, there's watching the warm up ain't gonna help me.
No, certainly not. So as we just sort of touched basically there simply on the discipline. It was something actually that in my sort of preview of the season when we had Anthony Russell from Banners of the Wall on that I said could be a potential issue because it wasn't the biggest roster at the start of the year. And we know we've got players in there who are that they occasionally do take the occasional suspension.
Yeah.
Is that something perhaps for next year we might look at numbers wise just to go a little bit higher?
Before I'd look at numbers wise, I'd look at discipline wise, to be honest with you. And I
As to
think,
why those suspensions were coming.
I think you've got to remember, not that I'm giving anyone an out or an excuse to be ill-disciplined. I came into a team that kind of had no rules, if that makes sense. It was a bit of a, like, what's that book? It's called Lord of the Flies. Like, they're all kind of running stuff themselves. Like, and that took me some time, mate. That was a challenge, I'll be honest. But I think we had a bum deal at one point during the season from certain officials that I'm not going to go on about. I've said my piece to the people that need to listen to it enough times. We're not bad, mate. For like our average penalty minutes are generally about 10 a game. So I mean, five minors, which is perfectly acceptable, perfectly normal. But certain things happen during the season that all of a sudden you're having games here and there where you're taking 40 and 50 minutes in penalties, and you're like, hang on a minute, this doesn't happen any other time. So that is what it is. And yes, absolutely. At the start of the season, discipline was not good enough, right? It was unacceptable, and it was costing us games through being on the kill all the time, tiring out guys that kill penalties, not getting good players on the ice enough because they're not penalty killers, et cetera, et cetera. All the reasons why coaches the world over bang on about staying out of the box, right? But I feel we turned a massive corner. And then every now and then we'll have a game and it'll be like going back to the old ways a little bit, just a little bit. And then I'll have to say my bit and it'll improve again. But I think I'm not going to go over individuals. I'm not going to curse anybody with a huge weekend coming up. But there are people in this team who may or may not have done things earlier in the season who've realised the error of their ways and have actually been really disciplined since. But it will probably take a whole season of that without the indiscretions that add up on the stat sheet to really turn over a leaf where everyone will go, oh my God, I can't believe so and so only took 28 minutes in penalties in the season. He said, yeah. So there's things that have changed massively for the better. And actually, if you look at this weekend, I know it was a bit of a strange weekend. I think we took 6 minutes of penalties over a weekend. I think the last few weeks, the Invicta away game frustrated me because I honestly wanted to get in and get out of there with no injuries, no penalties, no nothing. And we tried and tried to not get involved in that, but eventually we're kind of forced into it. And prior to that, I think when we played Streatham away a few weeks back, I don't think we had, I think we maybe took two or three minors. And that's the formula, mate. We all know it. If you sit in a box all night, you're probably not going to win many games. And if you do win them, it's probably not going to be against teams that are good teams with a good power play.
No, and it's yeah, I mean, I won't sort of bring out sort of personal names with, especially with officials and with players that may or may not be missing for this showpiece weekend that's coming up. But hopefully, I think the Department of Player Safety is going to have a bit of a shake up for next year. But there's a very fine line, as you say, between handing out a punishment that's good enough for the player to say, I don't want to do that again. But it's also not so lenient that they just say, oh, well, I'll just do that every week.
Well, it's for me, it should be about education, especially for younger players. Actually, we haven't seen it. Well, actually, we have. So young Eden got banned in an under-18s game for, I think, three games, right, for doing something. It might have been two games, but I think it was three. So because the under-18s league in this country is such a joke and they hardly play any games, it took him, like, I think 2 months to serve his ban. Now, if you're banned from a league, an age group or a league or whatever, you have to serve your ban at that level before you can play at any other level. So we're looking at a 16-year-old kid. I think he's 17 now, maybe still, I'm not sure, but 16 or 17 at the time, who has missed about 3 months of hockey because he's done something in an under-18s game. At the key crucial part point of development, right? But like, what are we trying to do here? And then you see these other bits, like this kid up in Hull got banned for 20 games for a check to the head, which I can't even see a check to the head on
No, I
that.
think we've all seen the video. I don't think anyone can
Yeah.
see what they're going on about there.
And actually, what all of this has done, and now I'm going to sound like a dinosaur, right? So I'm old, right? I appreciate I'm old. I'm the oldest person in the room, right? I'm the oldest person on the bench. Like, What the current, and I've been away for a while. Yeah, I had a year off coaching altogether, and then away from this league for a long time. It's turned into like a bit of a rat league, right? Where there's players around that will just, they basically just go around and do whatever the hell they like. Because if someone says to them, "Oh, you're gonna have to fight me now," they'll just go, "Nah," and just skate off. Or they'll cover up the player that, you know, has tried to fight and will end up getting a penalty. God knows what Dops are gonna make of it, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And you know, like I said, I'm old, right? But I knew when I was a player, if I hit someone from behind, if I ran into a goalie, slashed the goalie in the hand when he was covering the puck, I'm probably going to get punched in the face for it, right? And that's a decision that I would make, right? I might be trying to get my team going. I might go and hit the goalie on purpose so someone grabs me and it might, you know, my team's a bit flat or whatever. But it's got to a point where the way it's officiated and the bans, the DOPS stuff, it's just allowed people to be kind of weasels who just go around doing what they want. And then when someone goes, "You can't do that," and they go, "What are you gonna do about it?" "Well, I'm gonna fight you." They go, "Well, I'm not fighting you." But like, and Matt, it's probably me that needs to change, mate. You know, I've said this a few times, like maybe it's me that needs to change. The game has changed. I am a firm, honestly, whether it's one of my players or an opposition player, I don't want to see people getting hit from behind. I don't want to see deliberate hits to the head. Sometimes hits to the head happen, right? But like, I don't want to see deliberate ones. Like, I don't want to see like nasty stuff, nasty stick infractions, like, you know, people get sticked in the face and things like that. But I want hockey to still be hockey. And I think that Dops have got it wrong. I think that if someone gets run from behind in an avoidable, you know, yeah, sometimes guys turn and they get hit from behind, it's an accident, right? Or someone runs someone and elbows them square in the head. Those guys should get banned. I am fully on board with that. And if that's one of my players, I'll tell them, like, "Well, yeah, you deserve that. Like, I don't want to see that." But it's also then just assisted other players to actually be just as dirty in other ways. And it's took that kind of honour out of the game a little bit where you've got to answer for your own actions and things like that. So I've not been a big fan of it. We've tried to adjust as best we can, but you know, we've been hit by it, and I'm sure I don't think there's a team in the league that haven't, right? Everyone's
Yeah, I
been
think everyone's
hammered
kind of
by it
suffered the
at
sort of
some point.
misfortune of being on the end of some of this DOPS stuff. Obviously, a lot of it came out after the Darcy Flanagan and Joe Llewellyn incident and whatnot.
Yeah.
There's a lot of stuff that came out after that. But like I say,
But
hopefully moving forward, it should be
you
changing.
know, you look at that, and I spoke to Shane Moore and stuff at the time, and I was like, "Look, that was really early on in the season." And I remember that day when that ban came out, we were away in Solent the first time we went to Solent. I went in the room and said, "Oh, boys, I don't even know what's a penalty anymore." I was like, "Just be care, like, be careful." But I don't know what I'm telling you to be careful of, because I don't know what to tell you you can't do.
No.
Like, because I still cannot. I mean, I don't care about him getting banned because he's got enough to do with me. But I still, if I watch that video again, which it still sometimes pops up, I cannot for the life of me see where that ban came from.
No.
You
No,
know, it's mental.
it's worrying, isn't it? And as you
Yeah.
say, is a lot of it has to be about more about education than punishment, but you can't have them same people that are handing out them punishments providing the education, because then where the hell are we going to be?
Don't know where we are, mate. It's let
No.
alone where we're going to
But after, say, a good season, there's no two ways about it. It was an absolutely good season. We do come down to the showpiece, Ali Pally, this weekend. Are you looking forward to it personally?
Yeah, I love a Final Four weekend. Obviously, generally for me, it's always been that Coventry weekend that I've been involved in. I think if you lose, like, weekend just gone, you're always like, yeah, everyone packs up and goes, "Oh, thank God, I'm done." Like, 'cause it's a long old season. It's tough on all of us, especially the players. But if you lose that weekend, I just feel like you're just sitting at home looking at Twitter and looking at like updates going, "Oh, wish I was there," you know, because you're two games away. Yeah, I love a Final Four weekend, and I think it is fitting, to be honest, that the top four teams have qualified. I kind of looked, and I, you know, And I'm never ever count my chickens, but I did think Streatham would go through, and I did think that we would go through. I kind of knew Slough would go through, but I thought, you know what, if Romford catch them on the day, and then that happened on the first day, and then
Yeah.
I sort of said last night to the guys, I was like, I think Slough will score early, and then it would just be business as usual. And I don't know what time any of the goals went in because I was obviously coaching the game myself, but
It was a nine minutes, I think, their first one.
yeah, and then the only one I thought was a bit of a coin toss was the Invicta Solent. You know, I think if Invicta had gone in there with a little bit of a lead, maybe. But that's a hard place to play a hockey game, mate. You know,
Yeah.
I don't think. Don't get me wrong, I've never tried to coach a team in a ring like that, so don't like I'm not criticizing anything with Alex and that. But I think if that's your home ring, you should never lose.
Yeah, I've said the same to him when he was on here. I said you should never be beaten in that rink.
But I know it's not that easy because I've been in there and won this year, right? It's
Yeah.
not that easy. And I used to go and play or take teams as a coach to the Isle of Wight, and we used to win.
Yeah.
But God, that rink's an advantage. Like it is like Man United going to play Luton Town, and not only is it a terrible stadium, but they're playing on a five-a-side pitch as well.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah. So
I
yeah,
think
I think it's fitting that the best four teams have got there. You know, we knew it would be Slough or Romford. And you know what? You've got to beat everyone. Yeah, apart from the one team that gets knocked out of the other semi-final, you're gonna have to beat two very good teams to lift that trophy. Whoever ends up lifting it come Sunday night. Whether that's Slough and you know, we beat Slough, go and play Streatham, whether that's Slough beat us, go and play Solent, whoever it is,
Yeah.
you're playing two good teams to lift that trophy, and you wouldn't want it any other way, to be honest with you.
No, and as far as record goes, I think Chelmsford are 2-2 against Streatham and Slough, and I think they're 3-1 against Solent. So it's
No, 2-2
was
against
it two and
Solent,
two against
funny
Solent as
enough.
well?
Yeah.
So that, I mean, you couldn't
But
really get much more of an even weekend.
no, but the thing that skews it a little bit is that, like, we have played Slough so many times, right? By the time we played them that last final time, I knew there was a possibility the way you know, between us, we were going to be second and third, which meant if we both came through a quarter final, we'd end up playing again. So we knew we'd end up playing Slough because one of us was going to finish second and one of us was going to finish third. And I actually said to the boys last time we played them, like, I don't want to play this team again for a long time, but I'm happy to do it in a Final Four weekend, you know? And I'm sure they feel the same about us. It's been a lot. I think it's 10 times we've played them this season.
Yeah.
So by the time it comes down to Saturday, we're going to have played them 11 times, and that's a lot. And you know, I am excited about playing Slough now, and that's exactly how I thought I'd feel because, you know, it's real high stakes now. You know, it was this weekend. Obviously, the game didn't end up being quite as competitive as it could have been, but it was high stakes, and now it is real high stakes, right? You win or you go home, and that's the end. And you can do absolutely nothing about that to rectify it till September.
No.
And that's about as high stakes as it gets at this level of sport.
Yeah, and to be fair, I mean we've had a few players and a few other coaches say that they're not overly keen on the showpiece weekend. They prefer it to be a home and away thing. But for me, it's as you say, you've got the four best teams in the league, losing you're out. I don't think it gets much more exciting than that. I'm massively looking forward to it to myself. I'm. As far as I know, I'm commentating on the live stream, so that'll be exciting for me as well. It'd be great to
Yeah, it will be, yeah.
call a Chelmsford game for the first time. So,
Yeah. I think
yeah.
business-wise, home and away would be far more beneficial to the teams.
Yeah. I think the owners would prefer that, wouldn't they?
Absolutely, and I understand why. I've got experience of the management side of the game as well, and 100%, but and also I'm not a big fan of the fact that there's eight teams playing across two leagues. Like,
Two dressing rooms.
I think the situation could get messy in the rink with timings and dressing rooms, and I can't see many people sitting there from 10 o'clock in the morning till 11 o'clock at night. So I think you're going to have maybe the middle of
I'll
the
be
day is,
one.
Yeah, but I think the middle of the day might be kind of swollen with attendance, but both ends might be a little bit.
Yeah, I think we'll be the 7:30, won't be the last game, will be the Chelmsford Slough game.
That's right. That's correct. Yeah, and obviously I'm looking forward to it. I'm not sure it's been planned, but you know what? I'm always happy to admit when I'm wrong, and I'm more than happy to change my mind if I get there and I say, oh, you know what? This has been really well organized and really well planned.
Yeah.
So,
Now, well, I say I'm really looking forward to it, and I'm sure that everyone that's going is really looking forward to it. I just will say, well, thank you so much for joining me today, for what you've done with Chelmsford this year. We're looking forward to more of the same next year, and maybe even a little bit better. And
yep,
good luck for the weekend,
no.
Cliff.
Thanks a lot, mate. Thanks for having me on. I've been probably putting you off all year, but
No, no.
yeah, it's you know, we're in the home straight now. There's maximum of 6 days left of the season, and we're going to be doing everything we can to win, to lift the trophy on Sunday. But so are the other three teams that are there, right? So everyone's going to come in with their A game and may the best team win come Sunday evening.
Absolutely. Best way to sign it off. Lewis Clifford, thank you so much, mate.
Cheers, mate. Thank you.
A massive thank you to Lewis Clifford for joining me on the podcast. It's I know the coaches are so busy with everything they do in hockey, let alone, their real life, their jobs, their families and whatnot. So really do appreciate him giving his time. And to shout out, I didn't I the clips I normally get from the coaches, actually, that come in for the coaches' thoughts on the podcast, I don't always listen to them all the way through before I put it in the podcast. And then I don't hear it until I listen back when it's completed. So yeah, I said in there that I gave a personal thank you to Carl and to Alex and to Jason and to Ben for their thoughts across the season. I think it's a great addition to the podcast that the guys do that. We've had other things as well occasionally from captains of clubs, which is great. But yeah, a couple of them, I think Carl and Jason put some nice things in there about what the podcast has been doing for the league, covering it. It's been an incredible season. It's been my first full season of doing it. Thoroughly enjoy it still. Trying to get these episodes out as quickly as I can on a Monday because, I can't really keep up with Twitter. Everyone kind of knows by Sunday night what's been going on. But I really do hope you've all been enjoying the roundup episodes, kind of the new format that I've done it in. So Monday or Tuesday, depending on how quickly you can get it out, you should have a roundup episode. And then every week, trying to have at least one person on from around the league or just around the world of hockey. And yeah, I've thoroughly enjoyed it. A massive thank you to everybody that's been a part of the podcast this year, even just by listening or liking one of the social media posts. You are a part of it. You are helping it do what I sort of planned it to do. I started this podcast because when I started following the hockey at this league, after a year or two, I'm sort of looking around thinking, well, where's all the details? I can't find anything online about the league, other than the stats and tables and the fixtures. I want to know what's going on in the clubs. I want to, let's hear from the players, let's hear from the coaches, let's find out what's going on. So that was why I started it. Hopefully I've done that, and I really do hope that you have enjoyed it. As I said, two more episodes to come from the playoffs to take us up to number 100. 101, then we'll probably be reviewing the season and we'll have our team of the year that we'll put out, which the stats are virtually spelt out. I've not quite made my final decisions yet. It won't all be down to the stats. Just from what I've watched, there's certain players that are more important to their team than numbers. They do certain different things for their team than numbers that'll always, for me, have a shout into getting that player of the year. It's kind of as the teams are all winding into their end of season presentations where they're asking for supporters, players of the year. There's things that supporters look for in players that are more than numbers. So a lot of that will apply when I pick my team of the year. And then I'm sure I'll put something out there as well and invite you guys to do the same thing. Try and pick a dream team from the Britain Division, maybe using no more than one player from each club, or try and pick a whole sort of 20-man roster using a maximum of a couple or three from each club. So we'll see how that all goes, and that will come out after the 100th episode, as well. So we've had a couple of things, of course, this week in ice hockey, in British ice hockey, English ice hockey, more like from England ice hockey. The Volunteer of the Month has been announced, and I'm so happy to say it is Chelmsford Chieftains Caroline Fillery who's won the Volunteer of the Month. Caroline is incredible. Anybody that comes to Chelmsford, you may not know Caroline's name, But you will know Caroline as soon as you hear her shout 50-50. I wasn't actually aware until TJ was on Zero Pucks Given last year that she is TJ Fillery's mum. So it's yeah, I think she's got involved with TJ's playing. Obviously, she's volunteered for Chelmsford for many, many years and doing the 50-50. If you look through the YouTube actually on Zero Pucks Given, you will find at the playoffs last year that she interviewed me. We sat down in the stands together and got the mics out and we had a funny little chat for a couple of minutes. She's an incredible lady. She does an incredible job doing the 50-50 at Chelmsford. The week just gone in the playoff quarterfinals against Oxford was actually the biggest prize pot available from the 50-50 for this season. So, you know, great work from everybody giving their money out. And she does it in such a lovely way. It's kind of almost it's persuasive. She's a great salesperson. You want to give her your money and you want to have that chance of taking home that 50-50 prize. So massive congratulations to Caroline Fillery. All my love out to her. She knows how much I think of her. And the lovely words that she always gives me about the podcast. She's not on social media or anything like that. So she sticks it on YouTube in the kitchen when she's doing the washing up. So she tells me. So yeah, massive thanks to Caroline. Congratulations to you. That is thoroughly well deserved as England Ice Hockey's Volunteer of the Month. The GB Senior Ladies are also in action out in Riga in Latvia. They've had three games so far. They took a 1-0 win over Italy. They took a very hard-fought 3-2 defeat in overtime to Poland after being 2-0 up. I'm sure that would have hurt the girls. And I think just today, they've had a 7-1 defeat to Slovakia, who were favourites out there. So that's no shame in that at all. After we've done the playoff episodes, when we come back, we will be joined by Great Britain captain Jodie Alderson-Smith. So really, really looking forward to having Jodie on the podcast, talking all about their trip to Riga and her career as well. So keep your eyes on the socials for all of that. Subscribe on all of the Spotify's, the Apple Podcasts, the YouTubes. You don't miss anything that way. It's the best way to do it. A little later this week, obviously, depending as to when you're listening to this episode, is coming out on Thursday. Thursday night at 9 p.m. There's going to be something quite special happening over on YouTube. 4,000 and counting are going to go live on YouTube at 9 p.m. on Thursday with myself and Anthony Russell from Banners of the Wall. So we are going to be kind of discussing this whole England ice hockey year that's gone past. Looking at Dops because it's been quite a talking point. Looking at the playoffs that are coming up in the Elite, in the National, and of course in the Conference. North 1, South 1, North 2, South 2. We'll be looking at all of it, chatting about all of it. Because it's live, it's on YouTube, you can get involved, get in the chat, and it could just be one massive open forum for ice hockey fans across the UK. So 9 p.m. Thursday night on YouTube, 4,000 counting YouTube. I don't think there's a way that we can simulcast it onto mine and onto Anthony Russell's, but if there is, we will certainly do that. But just keep your eye out for that coming up at 9 o'clock on Thursday. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you once again to Lewis Clifford and congratulations again to Caroline Fillery. Please enjoy the rest of your week. And if you are coming to Ali Pally, I'll be up in the commentary gantry. Come and see me, give me a little fist pump. And we'll hope we have a fantastic weekend of hockey. Thank you so much for listening. I'll see you next time. Hey guys, it's Ben from Zero Pucks Given. We've had our sponsorship with Manscaped extended by 1 month. So you've got one more month to get your 20% off and free shipping on all of Manscaped products from manscaped.com. As you can see from this before picture, I know I look like someone who used to be in good shape. I'm a little bit of a gorilla. I'm quite a hairy guy. So I took the Lawnmower 5.0 into the shower, and then with the interchangeable head, you take the long hair off with the clipper head, you flick it off for the razor head, and then you take the short hair off. And considering how hairy I am, this is the outcome. I think that's pretty darn good. Of course, once of there, it looked like a bit of a plucked chicken, and you kind of go all the way down, use the skin safe razor blade, the clipper blade, and that downstairs to get all of that cleared off. And then when you're done, you use the crop soother and the crop preserver, which is like a deodorant for your balls. Stops any of that sweating, any of that chafing, if you're sort of driving a lot, sitting in a van all day or something like that, or even if you're being active, going to the gym or training or anything fitness wise, stops from all of that rubbing and chafing, particularly when you wear the Manscaped boxers that are also in the picture, as they've got a nice sort of silk pouch at the front which keeps you all feeling nice and fresh. So then after that, I've used the weed whacker to get all the hairs around from up my nostrils and in my ears, which as you get older, trust me, they all start to appear out of nowhere. And then I've used my moisturizers with a little bit of bulldog stuff actually to just on my head after I've shaved that with a razor blade. You can get a Manscaped beard trimmer as well, which is something I'm definitely going to look at. It's got a lot of different attachments on it, so you can sort of do the lines in your beard and sort of skin fade it down, which is a really, really good product. I'm hoping I might get hold of one of them quite soon. So yeah, I think these products are absolutely brilliant. I do not put my name to anything that I don't like, and as you can see, I use them and I think they're great. So use the code 0pucks20 manscaped.com.